Hello everyone, and welcome to another Mailbox video. Long, long overdue.
I wasn't sure I'd ever see you again.
I'm quite sure.
Hey, Miss, I'm as happy as you are.
But never mind.
May I present Major
Here I am. And, got a bit of a World War II themed mailbox today, actually.
I just wish I could have been there to help.
Honestly. Mainly because I've been playing a few... fair few World War II games, one of which is this, which you're watching right now, which is Ruse, which is a game that someone pointed out to me a little while ago, probably on another Mailbox video, I think, saying it was a pretty good World War II strategy game. And I thought to myself, hang on a minute, just 1 second. I think I've got that. I think I picked it up on a Steam sale at some point, and sure enough, it was sat right there in my Steam library. I was like, right, screw it, let's install it. And it's okay. I haven't played in a little while beyond the first few levels. It didn't really grab me particularly, but it's not bad if you're into that sort of thing. Personally, I think I preferred the later games these guys made. The war game, European escalation, war game, airline battle. Even though I suck at them horribly, I feel like they had more depth to them. But anyway. Yeah, I've been playing a few games that were World War II themed, and I decided, screw it, let's just stick the recording on and use it in a mailbox video. So here we are. So anyway, yeah, I've got a bit of this, I've got a bit of Medal of Honor Allied Assault, because that went on sale on GOG.com a little while ago and I picked it up for nostalgia's sake. And then a bit of War Thunder at the end for you guys to watch in the background. But anyway, it's really just there as background filler. Probably don't even have to watch this video properly at all, really. Probably just put it in a tab and listen to it if you want. Although, there's one bit coming up that you might want to watch, but I'll get to that in a minute. Anyway, unfortunately, I need to start off this mailbox video with a bit of a rant, an angry rant, because recently I've been getting a hell of a lot of very, very, very... how to put this, irritating messages, big time irritating messages from a lot of people. Obviously I have not been uploading a lot of videos of late, and I'm beginning to lose count of the number of times I've explained why I'm not uploading a lot of videos of late. You know, it's because I'm at university, I've got work to do, I can't sit here uploading videos full time. It's not possible, it just isn't going to happen. And yet, it seems at the minute, every like third or fourth comment I get on any of my videos is, Jingles, where is the Skyrim? Why you no upload Skyrim? You know. Why are you not uploading more videos? Jingles, I like your videos, but it'd be nice if you uploaded more of them. All the time, constantly. Constantly, constantly, constantly. On every video I put up, I put the announcement video for my goddamn stream that I was doing. Yeah, by the way, I've been doing streams recently because my new internet connection allows me to do that. So, yeah. I usually announce them on Twitter, sometimes put a video up on here. So, you know, keep your eyes peeled. Because I'm streaming again. But anyway, I put up an announcement video to say that I was streaming. And yet I managed to get 3 comments on that saying, why you no upload Skyrim? I don't understand what people's problem is. Like, I appreciate that you enjoy the videos. I really do. I think it's great that you enjoy the videos. But I think some people, I don't know what it is, like, you're getting a little bit obsessed, almost. I had one particular... This was really the icing on the cake that made me decide to do this rant in the first place. I got one particularly creepy message from someone. I'm not going to name names. Saying and the message was simply titled that I should upload more Skyrim, and the contents of the message was a screenshot of my Steam profile showing how much Skyrim I'd been playing recently. Like, the last play date was November the 30th. The implication, of course, being I'm watching your Steam profile and you've not been playing Skyrim, why aren't you playing Skyrim? And that was the bit where I kind of stepped back and thought, whoa, okay, hold on. Just rewind there a second. You people are spying on my Steam profile now to find out if I've been recording Skyrim. Are you fucking serious? I mean, okay, you like the videos, but that's just unhealthy. That really is. They are just videos of a guy playing a video game, for Christ's sake. A video game that you've all played hundreds of times yourselves, probably. Get a grip. What the hell's your problem? Just, it left me speechless, honestly, it really did. Some people clearly have issues. Here's the thing, guys. I don't need this kind of weird, fucking creepy shit, and I don't need the stress it causes either. Seriously, if this I'm gonna call it harassment because that's what it is. If this harassment about me not uploading enough Skyrim for your personal free fucking entertainment doesn't stop, then I will stop doing Skyrim altogether. I'm sorry. I'm deadly serious. I will simply stop making Skyrim videos because it's not worth the stress to me. It really isn't. I don't care how many views they generate, and I don't care how much money those videos make me. It is not worth the stress. Okay? I don't get this with any other videos. I don't get this with the Fallout ones. I don't get it with War Thunder. I don't get it with Baldur's Gate. I don't get it with anything. Just the Skyrim videos. So, logically speaking, why the hell shouldn't I stop making the Skyrim videos? Because, clearly, you know, the enjoyment I get from making those videos is not worth this kind of bullshit. I don't know what to say, really. It's got to stop, otherwise Skyrim will stop. I'm sorry it's come to this. Sorry that I'm fucking surprised and slightly disappointed that I have to say this, but yeah, if it doesn't stop, I will stop making Skyrim. I am a very, very busy man. I have got plenty of work to do. I am trying to study a goddamn degree course here. I have bigger priorities than your personal free entertainment on a daily basis. I really do. I put these videos up when I can, when I have the ability to record, and when I'm in the right mindset to record. Because frankly, at the minute, every time I get one of these stupid comments, it makes me want to record even less. Every time I read someone yelling at me in all caps, "Why you not upload more Skyrim?" it makes me less likely to upload more Skyrim, because it really just kills it for me. And yeah, plenty of people probably saying now, "Yeah, but Jingles, you're a YouTube channel. You should expect this. You should expect this. The internet is like this." Now, I'm sorry. I've been doing this for nearly 2, possibly 3 years now, and I have never had this problem to this extent before. And I don't like it, frankly. Oblivion was just it's a bloody good Let's Play as far as I'm concerned. I'm really happy with it. I'm really pleased with it. Loads of people really, really liked it. It has more views on it than the Skyrim one does, and yet that didn't cause this kind of ridiculous reaction to me not uploading it for a while. In fact, people were very bloody patient about it, and I thank them for that, and they're still being patient because I haven't had time to make any Oblivion in addition to the other stuff I'm doing. But at the minute, I just, you know, if this keeps up, I'm just going to stop doing Skyrim. I am. Might do Oblivion instead, who the fuck knows? Because that didn't cause me problems, but Skyrim apparently does. Jeez. Anyway. Oh yeah, rant over. Don't take it too personally, but yeah. I'm not happy bunny about this right now. And it's got to stop, like I said, so anyway. Dear me. Anyway, okay, so on a brighter note. Some of you who have been going to my live streams and stuff will have noticed, will be aware that I actually have a copy now of the Elder Scrolls Anthology, which, for those of you who don't know, is a big old box set released by Bethesda to celebrate the anniversary of the Elder Scrolls or whatever, containing every single Elder Scrolls game to date on disc. Including a bunch of nice extra things like maps and stuff. All comes in a very nice box and that sort of thing. And I floated while I was doing the stream and the idea of doing maybe an unboxing video or something. I normally wouldn't do that, but, you know, come on. It's the Elder Scrolls Anthology, you know. If I'm not going to do an unboxing video for that, what the hell am I going to do it for? And surprisingly, people were actually like, "Oh yeah, 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 go, do it. Want to see it." And I was like, well, okay then. Of course, I quickly realised afterwards I don't have the equipment or set up to do a proper unboxing video at all. No, sir. I don't even have a proper camera. So what I thought I would do is I'd show you it anyway. But I'm literally going to record this on my iPhone. Because that's the best camera I've got, sadly. So the quality is going to be awful. But if I could slip it into this mailbox video now, it won't count as an unboxing, a proper unboxing video. It'll just be me showing you the game informally and stuff. So, yeah. For those of you who are interested, this is the Elder Scrolls Anthology.
Ta-da! There we go. There it is. The Elder Scrolls Anthology in all its glory. So this is what you get, basically. You get this big-ass box, about yay big, you can see there next to my hand. Comes in this plastic wallet, it's got a bunch of stuff on the back, you know, the Elder Scrolls saga, now available as an award-winning collection, blah 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 blah. So let's open it up and see what's inside, right? Let's get this open, then you inexpertly try and slide it out with one hand. dump that over there, don't need that anymore. So yeah, you got this nice little box here, made out of, well, expensive looking cardboard, I suppose. It looks quite nice though, it's going to look pretty sweet on the shelf. But then you've got this insert here, which, I'll just slide out, there we go. And you've basically got this book thing, the Elder Scrolls Anthology, and you open it up and you've got Arena, and then you fold out this side here, and then yeah, you've got a little bunch of little screenshots of the game, and you've got the disc itself. Now, I haven't tried this out yet, but I believe, according to what Bethesda have said, and I really apologise, by the way, for this jerky camera stuff the other minute, but like I said, I'm recording this on my iPod, and I don't have a tripod or anything, so this is why I'm not doing a proper unboxing video, but anyway, so apparently, with Arena and Daggerfall, these discs come with a pre-installed version of DOSBox, which makes the installation and running of the games pretty painless and straightforward. That's of particular interest, I suppose, to me, because for whatever reason, I've never been able to get Arena running properly on my computer very well. So I'm hoping this disc version will actually run better than the downloaded free version that you can get these days. So yeah, there's that, basically. The Bethesda's coders have had a look at it and tried to make it work as best as possible themselves. Then there's a good chance that hopefully it should work for you and me. So anyway, apologies for the random finger there on the side of the video. I'm not very good at this, I'm afraid. So yeah, anyway, you've got Arena. Then you move over and you've got Daggerfall. Love that background art, by the way. That forest. Very cool. Same deal again. Got it on the disc here. The Elder Scrolls 2 Daggerfall. Just screenshots. Then that folds away. Then... Oh, look at that. Oh, look at that. Look at that concept art, background, or whatever that is. Presumably looking down from Red Mountain with all the Duemus Citadels. Oh, so cool. Fold it out again, and oh, instant nostalgia hit. Look at that. Look at all those pictures. Look at those discs. And yeah, look, it has got a disc copy of the construction set, which is actually annoyingly difficult to get your hands on if you've got the Steam version of Morrowind. And I'm particularly happy to have a disc version of Morrowind again, not only because I now have the construction set again, but also because the Steam version of Morrowind is exceptionally annoying when it comes to trying to mod it. I think it's to do with the BSA files or something. They're registered to different dates with the Steam version of Morrowind than they are with the regular disc version, which makes modding very, very, very annoying, because you have to go into INLA files and rename things and change the dates for things with, like, complex file editing software, and it's very, very annoying, basically. And also you have problems with the Steam overlay as well, and it's just a big pain in the arse. So having this again on disc, brilliant. In fact, I'm probably going to uninstall my current copy of Morrowind via Steam and reinstall it on this disc for convenience. So anyway, you go over again, and oh, What do you mean, is Morrowind again? Well, actually, it's not technically Morrowind again. It's Tribunal and Blood Moon. Excellent. Got these on disc as well. So that's pretty awesome. Again, more screenshots. Lovely, lovely, lovely screenshots. I remember seeing some of these in bloody PC Gamer back when Morrowind actually came out. Oh, so good. Particularly that shot there with the Ordinator outside the big old temple in Mournhold. Oh, nostalgia hits all over the place. So yeah, you've now got Tribunal and Blood Moon on disc. Of course, remember that you need to install Tribunal before Blood Moon, otherwise it will break your game. But before you ask, unfortunately, there is no kind of physical manuals with these. There's a little insert in the back which with an address, you know, a web address with all the manuals on in electronic format, but sadly no physical manuals. But for those of the uninitiated who perhaps haven't played Morrowind, actually, and are thinking of getting this anthology just so you can have all the Elder Scrolls games, install Tribunal first and then Blood Moon afterwards. You have to do it in that order, otherwise the game will break for some reason that was never fixed by Bethesda. So yeah, so there you go, you've got Tribunal and you've got Blood Moon. Now, turning over, we have Oblivion. Again, lovely, lovely concept art in the background there. I fold it out, and you have got a two-disc installation of Oblivion Game of the Year Edition, which includes The Shivering Isles and Knights of the Nine, and presumably all the little mini DLCs as well. And yes, that probably includes horse armor. So yeah, there you go. You've got Oblivion. Awesome. Again, the Steam version of Oblivion is not quite so bad as the Morrowind one for modding, but I'm probably going to install this anyway, the non-Steam version, because it will allow me to actually have two Oblivion installations, which means I might actually finally be able to play Nairim at Fate's Edge, which is a total conversion mod for Oblivion, which people have been asking me to play since God knows when, and I've been wanting to play since God knows when, but unfortunately because of Steam, I couldn't have more than one installation, but now... now I can. Oh. So anyway, there's that. And then obviously you turn over and, unsurprisingly, we have Skyrim. With that admittedly nice concept art, but we've all seen it a billion times before, so I don't like it as much as the others. And obviously you turn over and you've got one big fat DVD with Skyrim on it. It's like the Game of the Year edition, I believe, type deal. Yeah, it's Legendary Edition. Yeah, you can see that. Legendary Edition, which does include Dragonborn, Hearthfire, and Dawnguard. So there you go. You've got the whole shebang right there on that disc, which is pretty nice actually, because the disc version of Skyrim I have is just sort of like the standard release version of it. So this has probably got patches on it, and it's got all the expansions and stuff like that. So if I ever need to reinstall Skyrim by a disc, I've got this, which will be far more convenient. So, yeah, there you go. Believe it or not, actually, that is the third copy of Skyrim that I own. I now own three copies of Skyrim. I have one digital version on Steam, which I got so that I could play the game the minute it was released. I have a boxed copy of the game from when it was released. And I also now have this, so the Legendary Edition as part of the anthology. So there you go, three copies of Skyrim. Question not my nerd credentials, dear viewers, because they are long and they are numerous. Anyway, so then you turn over and you've got this little back bit here, which is obviously a little map of Tamriel type thing, but the cool stuff is inserted in here. Now you've got, I don't know what the hell this is, it's some kind of sticker saying sign up for beta for the Elder Scrolls Online. I've already voiced my opinion on the Elder Scrolls Online, so the less said about that the better. Then you've got this warranty information rubbish, but here's the good stuff. Here's the good stuff, ladies and gentlemen, and I'm gonna see if I can try and get this out with one hand. This is the stuff that a lot of you, I'm sure, have been wanting to see, myself included. When I've heard that they were including these, this is what made me want to buy the anthology in the first place. So, what we have here are maps. Maps, ladies and gentlemen, lots and lots of maps. We've got, obviously, ones you've probably seen before, and you've undoubtedly seen before, which includes the... oh, grief. Folding maps one-handed is not easy for you, folks. Obviously, the Oblivion map, which is nice because my old one got all torn up and lost. So it's nice to have a replacement for that. So that's pretty cool. You know, we've all seen the Oblivion map before, I'm sure. So there's that. Just move that out of the way. We have the Skyrim map, obviously, and not sadly the pre-order canvas map like I've got at home, but and I'm never going to be able to unfold this properly, am I? Damn it! Alright, there we go, obviously. So yeah, there is the Skyrim map, which again, I'm sure you've probably all seen, but there it is regardless. Like I said, it's not the nice canvas one, it's just the regular old paper one, but still, who cares, it's a big old fantasy map, we all love big old fantasy maps, this one being no exception. In fact, I think I probably like this one more than the Oblivion one, just because this reminds me more of, like, sort of, those J.R.R. Tolkien Middle-Earth maps, if you know what I mean. It's a bit more stylized, which I quite like, so there you go, you've got that. And now the interesting stuff. The interesting stuff, the stuff that probably piqued people's interest the most, right? Well, first off, we've got a map of... You probably saw Sea of Ghosts there, but... so no prizes for guessing what this is, but... You have got a map of Vardenfell. In all its glory, look at this thing, it's so detailed. Now, unfortunately, This is a map that is unique to the anthology, I believe, because the original map that actually came with boxed versions of Morrowind was in colour. It was a coloured map, but this one obviously is in sort of the sepia-toned, Yoli mappy style, but it still uses the original drawing. So as you can see, I'm going to zoom in here a little bit. Sorry about the glare on the camera there, but it's because of the lighting setup I've got here. And you can see that it is incredibly detailed. It's one of my favourite maps of a fantasy world of all time, frankly. It has every single little path, every little rocky mountain range, every tiny island. It's all there in just immaculate detail. This map must have taken weeks to draw. I mean, it's insane. Look at this thing. And you're probably looking at this right now and you're thinking, right, yeah, exactly, I know what all these areas are of the map because I've been to them in the game, and you recognise them so well from this map. You've even got like the little Daedric ruins, like this one here, drawn on here, but their names are in Daedric. I mean, how brilliant is that? It's just fantastic. I love it. All the little towns drawn on there in little detail, that you can see Algarun with the little giant crab shell scar building, all that kind of stuff. You've got Fort Buckmoth next to it. Yeah, it's bloody fantastic. You've got Vivec down here, obviously. Sadruth Mora over there in the Zaphirbel Bay, and Wolverine Hall as well. So that's pretty awesome, I think you'll agree. This is going to be a favourite of mine. This one's going right up on the wall, definitely. Heck yes. So there you go. That is the map of Vardenfell. So now we're getting into territory that is previously unknown, if you know what I mean, because these games didn't really have maps. But first off, we've got this one. It's a very interesting map, and apologies viewers, I kind of need to do that two-handed for a second there. We have a map of the Iliac Bay, which I'm going to sit back and zoom out a little bit for you, just so you can see the whole thing. We have a map of the Iliac Bay, which is the region in which Elder Scrolls II Daggerfall takes place. Pretty cool, I think you'll imagine. I think it's adapted from the in-game map, which would explain why some bits of it look a little pixely. And you see that coastline over there? Yeah. But it's pretty cool nonetheless. It's not particularly detailed, but then again, there wasn't a lot of detail in that game in terms of landmarks. But as you can see, it's got the location. It's got the names of all the provinces. It's got the locations of the various capitals of those provinces. Like you can see Daggerfall right over there, the little castle. You've got Orsinium. You've got Weyrest. You've got Sentinel down here in Hammerfell. Yep. For those of you who weren't aware, Daggerfall actually took place in two provinces. It took place in this part of High Rock at the top and this part of Hammerfell down here. So it was pretty cool. And obviously the Rothgarian Mountains up there with Orsinium. And Dureni Tower over there on the Isle of Balfiera. That is one heck of a nasty dungeon, people. If you've ever played Daggerfall before, beware Dureni Tower. It is a horrifying place. So there you go. This is pretty cool. I'm pretty sure they made this specifically for the anthology because this didn't exist otherwise. Other than the old school pixely in-game map for the game, I don't think they ever made a physical map like this for it. So here it is. It looks pretty fantastic. I love this thing. Again, this one's going up on straight up on the wall. I think this is awesome. Real collector's piece this is. It makes me want to play Daggerfall all over again. In spite of all its myriad problems as a game, but oh, look at it. It's great. So anyway, that is the Daggerfall map, possibly my favourite after the Morrowind one of this entire set. But last but not least, I have to admit, is it's nothing particularly special, but it's also kind of cool because I don't think we've ever had a map for exactly like this before, as far as I'm aware anyway. Obviously, this is the map for Arena. And Arena, for those unaware, took place across the entirety of Tamriel. So for those of you who have been all constantly going, oh, the next Elder Scrolls game should be set across all of Tamriel, well, they kind of already did that. In the first Elder Scrolls game, which was Arena. And so, for Arena, we've got a bloody great map of Tamriel. The Empire of Tamriel, as it says down there at the bottom. Because, of course, this all was the Empire of Tamriel back when Arena took place. So there you go, you've got the whole shebang. And all the little provinces, like Elsewhere, and then all the little towns, Dune, Riverhold, Orcrest, Rimmon, Corinth, Somerset Isle over there. My money's on the Somerset Isle for the next Elder Scrolls game. Although, if it were up to me, I'd do a kind of Iliac Bay type thing, and, you know, zoom it out a little bit and maybe do something like that. That kind of region there. You've got a little bit of Cyrodiil, so you've got Anvil, which you could go back and visit again. Then you've got a bit of Vale and Wood, and you've got a whole of the Somerset Isle to explore. That would be my choice for a new Elder Scrolls game, this region right here. But anyway, so there you've got Sunhold, Dusk, Shimmerine, Alanor, Cloudrest, Skywatch, First Hold. All good stuff. Obviously you've got High Rock up there, the Iliac Bay region once again. Obviously, it looks a bit different on here because they updated the maps ever since they made Daggerfall. The Iliac Bay region, as you can see, doesn't look quite as squashed, but I like the fact that when they did the map for this anthology, they actually decided to stay faithful to the game itself when they were making that map, which I think that's good. I like that, so. You know, and there you go, you've got Black Marsh, Gideon, Black Rose, Lil Moth, Archon, and obviously Morrowind as well, including a few towns you may be familiar with if you've played Tamriel Rebuilt, like Firewatch, Necrom. Obviously you've got Mournhold down there, in case some of you maybe didn't know where Mournhold actually was, having played Tribunal, it's actually right there. You've got all the other towns, Narsis, Tyr. Tyr, I think, occasionally gets mentioned in dialogue during Morrowind, so there you go. And for those of you who have played Dragonborn and have met some of the Dunmer NPCs, that is where Blacklight is. It's actually just right there off the coast of Solheim. So, there's Blacklight. And there you go, so that's the great big gigantic map of Tamriel itself. So yeah, pretty awesome. That was the map from Arena. And that is pretty much it. That is the Elder Scrolls Anthology, pretty much in a nutshell. It is this book with all the discs and the maps, and that's what you get. It's around, I think I'll set you back, as far as I'm aware, about 40 quid. 40 quid, 45 quid. Needless to say, I mean, that's probably not a bad price, actually, for what you're getting. I mean, that's a lot of games, let's be fair. You know, that's Morrowind, that's Oblivion, that's Skyrim. Even if you discount Arena and Daggerfall, because they're free these days, that still seems worth it to me. But I actually got this on a Black Friday sale, believe it or not, actually, a game, for £17. So, pretty excellent bargain. So there you go. Elder Scrolls Anthology. Pretty sweet. I like it a lot. And for the curious among you, that is what it actually looks like when you get it out and you look at it. So there you go.
Alright, so that was the Elder Scrolls Anthology in a nutshell. Took slightly longer than I intended, but I got a bit carried away and I started looking at those maps, I'm afraid. I mean, can you blame me, really? So anyway, hope you enjoyed that. So it's probably time, now we've got all this rubbish out of the way, I answered some questions, right, since that's what this series is supposed to be for. So without further ado, first question for today comes from Seamus Kirk. And he has this to say. I don't know if you've been asked this before, but I'm going to ask it anyway. I first subscribed to your channel quite some time ago when you were doing your Kaiserreich vids. I was wondering if you would ever do another Let's Play of Kaiserreich or maybe another Grand Strategy game. Now, I've answered this before ages ago, and I said pretty much I wasn't going to do any more Kaiserreich because I'd had enough of it. But since then, I've kind of changed my mind a bit, actually. I'm starting to get that Hearts of Iron itch again, and it needs scratching. So I don't know. Maybe at some point I could. I don't like to talk about like future, what like Let's Plays and stuff like that at the minute because I barely have enough time to do the one that I'm getting on with at the minute. But at some point in the future, I wouldn't mind doing another Hearts of Iron Let's Play, whether or not it would be Kaiserreich or just regular old Darkest Hour Hearts of Iron. I don't know. I mean, Kaiserreich's pretty hilarious, but at the same time, it's still in beta, I think, so it's still relatively buggy. And unfortunately, I mean, as for those of you who did watch those videos, you'll know that the second campaign we did is the US actually was cut short by a game-breaking bug, so I don't really want that to happen again, so I might end up just doing regular Hearts of Iron. Who knows? But I'm not going to rule it out at all, because I like Hearts of Iron a lot. It's one of my favorite games of all time, in fact, especially Darkest Hour, which improves a lot of the stuff in the original Hearts of Iron 2. So, yeah, Hearts of Iron 2, like it a lot. Probably will play it again in the future, but, you know, don't ask for a date or anything, because I have no idea. So, next question. Well, it wasn't really a question. It's just something. Well, it comes from D. Stebbin, whose name I think I've pronounced correctly, I'm not sure, and he sent me a message quite a while ago. I didn't reply to it because I wanted to just reply to it in this video. He basically sent me a great big, it was to do with one of my Skyrim videos where I mentioned I basically kind of made this unfavorable comparison from Ulfric Stormcloak to Hitler, basically. A slightly hyperbolic comparison, it has to be said, but you know. And he sent me a big old message saying that he was of the opinion that actually what Bethesda were going for was trying to compare Ulfric to someone like George Washington, actually, which obviously, naturally, is a far more positive comparison than Hitler. And he sent this big message, very long one, wondering why he thought it was that way around, and I can't honestly, I'm not going to argue back with you about this or anything, because I think your opinion is just as valid as mine. It's one interpretation of the same character, isn't it? But I don't know, maybe it's not just a cultural thing. I as someone living in Britain who has had the upbringing that I have had, I look at a character like Ulfric Stormcloak and I see a tyrant, you know, a dictator in the making, you know, a warlord, essentially. But you clearly looked at Ulfric Stormcloak and you saw someone completely different. You saw, you know, a revolutionary and a leader fighting for freedom or whatnot. In my personal opinion, people that often claim to fight for freedom usually want anything but that. And I think Ulfric Stormcloak, in my opinion, is a classic example of that, really. I still hold to this day that he's kind of a bit of a religious fanatic. I mean, oh dear, like, you know, you, for the time being, because of some sort of political technicality as a result of a war, you know, you can't publicly, and this is the thing, publicly worship one of, you know, one god of part of a great big bloody pantheon, I might add, and you want to start a war over that. I mean, that's, you know, I don't think I can support anyone ever starting a war over religion. at all. I mean, it's just it's complete madness. You know, it's a difference of opinion, it's a difference of outlook and worldview and whatnot. You look at Elfric Stormcloak and you see basically a bearded Nordic George Washington. I see a bearded Nordic Idi Amin, basically. It's just one of those things, you know. But I'm glad you sent me that message. It was a good read. It was very well thought out and very well argued, and yeah, good for you. Good for you. Just goes to show that not everyone, I don't know, there's no right answer to a lot of things. So there you go. Okay, so moving on. I'm trying to get this as speedy as possible because I took a bit too long of that unboxing bit. But anyway, Hazman has this to say: I hate to be that guy, but will you be continuing Baldur's Gate? You know what? I'm gonna let you off the hook, Hazman, because having just ranted about this for people constantly asking me about Skyrim, you're probably the only person who has asked me about Baldur's Gate like for the last 3 or 4 months. So you know what? Fair play to you. I've got more videos of Baldur's Gate to go, but I haven't been actively recording any more, if that's what you mean. I intend to finish Baldur's Gate one day. Main reason being, well, there's two reasons actually. One being, actually, as much as people seem to enjoy like my Elder Scrolls and Fallout stuff a lot more than my Baldur's Gate videos, judging by the view count anyway, I've actually probably had a lot more fun playing Baldur's Gate than I have a lot of Oblivion or Skyrim, actually. Because Baldur's Gate is still kind of, it's a vaguely new experience for me. I mean, I've played a lot of it before, and I know some of the plot and stuff like that, but I've not played it anywhere near as much as, say, Fallout 3 or Skyrim. So, Baldur's Gate for me is, in a way, actually kind of a lot more exciting. And I've really enjoyed playing it. And also, in addition to that, I recently actually got my hands on the Baldur's Gate 2 Enhanced Edition, which has finally been released. And I'm itching to have a go at that, because that, again, it's Baldur's Gate 2, which, you know, people can never stop praising, because it's just that good. But I've never actually played it myself, because I'm always of the opinion with these things. It's the same with The Witcher. This is why I haven't played The Witcher 2. I always decide I have to finish the first game, regardless of how good or bad it is, before I move on to the second. It's just a thing with me. I can't, it annoys me, like, the idea of skipping straight to the second game. I can't do it, for whatever reason. It's a little bit OCD, I suppose, but since I still haven't finished Baldur's Gate 1, I'm not going to go on and play Baldur's Gate 2, even though I own the Enhanced Edition. I kind of bought it in advance, if you know what I mean. But I played like 5 minutes of the Enhanced Edition, just to see what it was like, and it's pretty great. Loads of nice new features, and all that kind of stuff, you know. Obviously things like graphical updates, user interface changes, that sort of thing. Looks really great, looks really snazzy, and I can't wait to have a go at it, but I can't really do it. I can't bring myself to play it until I finish Baldur's Gate 1 for the first time. So, basically, yeah, eventually I'm going to be carrying on with Baldur's Gate, and I'm going to finish that damn game even if it kills me. So, yeah, there'll be more of that on the way, I'm sure. Obviously, I've got plenty of videos I could upload for you right now, and I will do that if and when I'm able to. And then I will try and get back to recording it actively as well once those are all done, I suppose. So yeah. Okay. So moving on. Next question comes from Prince Sephiroth, and he asks: out of all the characters you've role played as, which was your favorite and why? Well, you just. There was this one character, you know, that was so great that I kind of named my channel after him. but no, in all seriousness, favorite character. It's none of the ones I've put on this channel. It's probably, and honestly, I can't even remember his name. I think it might have been Thaidas. I think it might have been where I pinched the Thaidas name for when I started playing more Oblivion. But I'm pretty sure I spelt it differently. I think it was like Theydas or something. And he was a dark elf. It was Morrowind, by the way, in case you were wondering. Before I get too ahead of myself, but yeah, it was Morrowind. and he was a dark elf. Was it a sorcerer or a mage? It might have just been a custom class. But anyway, the guy was basically a sort of a summoner. You know, he summoned creatures to fight his battles for him, had a bit of destruction magic. But mainly, he would summon creatures, and he would roll around with basically a gigantic claymore and wizard robes, and he would summon creatures. And it was just so much fun to play. It really was. Because you could summon bound armor and bound weapons, and you could summon all sorts of monsters. And there was no limit on the number of monsters you could summon, as far as I was aware. So you could summon a whole horde of the bloody things to fight your way through ancient ruins with. And eventually, because Morrowind being the way, the skill system in it being the way it was, I had enough money eventually to actually train him to use heavy armor, so he became a sort of battle mage towards the end of the playthrough. And what made him particularly memorable was the fact that he was the Nerevarian, basically. He did the main quest and everything, but he was this kind of bit of an anti-hero in the sense that he was actually kind of an evil wizard. He was obsessed with power, and he became like, you know, he joined House Tel'vani, became head of House Tel'vani, he had Tel Uvarith as his big base of operations, his gigantic evil wizard tower, got a bunch of mods to pimp that place out, make it even more awesome, that sort of thing. And he actually, you know, I believe he, he defeated Dagothur. But the great thing about it was that I actually used a mod, which was very, very buggy, actually, and broken, and probably still is, if you can even download it anymore, which allowed you to become a lich. Through a very complex process of gathering loads and loads of random annoying little ingredients from all across the world, like certain plants from Solheim, a bunch of like specific pieces of pottery, and you know, like for brewing chemicals in and stuff like that, a bunch of random alchemical ingredients, stuff like that, so that you could make this potion. And then you had to try and carry out this ritual using three particular items, I think it was soul gems or something, placing them on a flat surface in a sort of triangle shape, and performing this ritual on the dead of midnight, like on the dot of midnight. And obviously the scripts for it were a bit awkward, and the mod didn't work very well, and it was a bit broken, but hilariously enough, like the difficulty I had in actually managing to get the lich stuff done, kind of added to the immersion for it, because it felt so damn difficult to do, so that when I finally did it and this character finally became a lich, it was really, really satisfying. And it was good fun. It was good fun. It was totally unbalanced, though. It was ridiculous. It was kind of like vampires in Morrowind as well, really, when I think about it. Totally unbalanced, practically broke the game. So I had to actually edit the mod myself, so that you basically, the way it worked is you had this spell that you could use, which would temporarily make you appear like a human, or you know, just a living thing, as opposed to basically a walking skeleton, which is what you were when you were in lich form. And what it would do is it would deaden your powers. It would make you you would be incapable of casting any spells while the spell was active. So that was a nerf enough in itself, I feel. But in the original mod, you could only cast it for about 20 seconds, which obviously was completely impractical when you were going around in a town or something. And, you know, you really needed to go around in towns in that game, because I was trying to do Tribunal at the time, because I'd finally finished the main quest. I wanted to move on and do Tribunal. And it was getting incredibly difficult to do when I could only appear in public for 20 seconds at a time. So I edited the spells so that it was almost like a constant effect type thing, but obviously it made you incapable of casting spells. So that meant that while he was in living mortal form, he was basically defenseless, because he was a mage character, you know. So, but obviously being in lich form gave him loads of crazy stat bonuses, and yeah, that's how he defeated Dagothur. He became a lich. That's how he got the power to defeat Dagothur. He became a lich, and he went to Red Mountain, and they had the most epic of battles, I assure you. And afterwards, he built himself a special, like, part of the mod was you could build a sort of lair for your lich, you know, like your own sort of little doom fortress underground or whatever. And I built it at the top of Red Mountain, and he lived at the top of Red Mountain, where Dagothur pretty much used to, I guess. After he defeated Dagothur, he just kind of just moved in. And that was what he did, and then he went off and did Tribunal, and that was probably the most fun I've ever had with a character in, say, an Elder Scrolls game, or just any RPG in general, really, now I think about it. That guy was goddamn awesome. He really was. I missed that character. I lost a save game for it years ago. But he was awesome. He was pretty great. Even if the mod was so buggy, I think eventually I probably stopped playing that character just because the mods I had were getting so out of hand and breaking the game. But yeah, that is the most fun I've had with a character in an RPG. So there you go. Okay, final question. It's not really game related, and it comes from The Greater. If you could live in any country, county, other than whichever county Norwich is in, it's in Norfolk, by the way, Greater. You should know this. Come on, mate. Unacceptable, honestly. which one would it be? Well, the answer to that, this is a two-part question, by the way, but the answer to that part is probably Yorkshire, because I spent a lot of my childhood on holidays in Yorkshire, and so I've got a lot of fond memories of the place. Went to York itself quite a few times, went to Whitby a whole bunch of times, saw the Abbey there, all that kind of stuff, went to the Yorkshire Moors. What a brilliant part of the UK. I would, if I had the choice of living anywhere in the UK, I think I'd probably choose to live there. If not here in Norwich, because Norwich is pretty great too, honestly. So there you go. That's the answer to that part of the question. But the other part of your question was, if you moved to America, which state would you want to live in? I don't know. I don't really know enough about America's various states and what they're like to actually make an informed decision, honestly. I know people. I have known people for some years now that do live in America. And the answer is I'd probably end up moving, if I had to move to America, I'd probably end up trying to move as close to them as possible, actually, so at least I'd know someone, you know. But as for a specific state, I couldn't honestly tell you. Probably somewhere on the East Coast or the West, furthest West Coast, because I seem to get the impression those are the most, shall we call, civilized parts of the US. I'm not sure I'd fit in very well in the Midwest or the South. Just a hunch. Apologies to anyone who lives there who's terribly offended, but I'm English, I'm British. We get a very, very strangely coloured perception of what living in America is actually like over here. You can't really blame me, man. It's my upbringing. I'll blame it on that. There you go. I've never been to America, so I have no idea what it's really like over there, to be honest. So there you go. Anyway, that's all the questions for this week. Phew. Oh, this video was probably way longer than I intended, but never mind. At least it's done now. Yeah, hope you enjoyed the unboxing video. I hope my little rant caused you to quake in your boots with terror. I hope you enjoyed this little bit of game footage in the background as well. If I've timed this correctly, you should right now be watching me flying around in my Thunderbolt in a historical battle on Midway, which was a pretty kick-ass battle, if I do say so myself. I'm really, really enjoying flying the Thunderbolt at the minute. It's a really, really good plane. In War Thunder, in historical battles anyway. It kind of sucks in arcade. So anyway, there you go. Thanks for watching, everyone. I'll see you all again pretty soon, and if any of you asks on this video where the hell is Skyrim, I will probably kick a puppy in the face. So, that's all, folks. See you next time.